So today I want to talk about a programming technique which isn't in any way by me or invented by me, but which I think is somewhat underappreciated. And I would like to tell you more about it. So the motivation is as follows. So here you have the Haskell interface of the ASIN library. Well, it's not the complete interface, but there are two type classes. You have one type class that's called TookJSON, which handles conversion of arbitrary Haskell data types into either values, which is a universally typed Haskell representation that can then be rendered to strings, or in latest versions directly to encodings, which are more direct and you can bypass the value intermediate stage and be more efficient. And then you also have a class from JSON, which deals with the other direction. Like there is completely generic code that can parse JSON strings into values, but values are not typed. And then you can, depending on the Haskell data type you want to produce, instantiate the from JSON class to tell how you can parse a particular Haskell data. Now let's look how that looks in practice. So if we have a concrete Haskell data type representing conference talks, and that might have a number, like an identifier, an author, a title, and let's say, in this case, binary track where a talk can be either a regular talk or a workshop, which is longer, then you can build a concrete value of this data type by just applying this make call talk constructor and passing the four arguments in and the record labels in Haskell. If you're not familiar with Haskell, record labels are optional, so you can use them, but you don't have to. You can also just pass the four arguments positionally as I would be. Okay? And now if we want to actually get a JSON representation, we have to start defining instances. So we go for track, which is our own binary data type. A track is either regular or workshop. And we write a conversion that says, okay, if we have a regular, we want to represent it as the string, as the JSON string regular, otherwise as a workshop. For the parser, we have to do more work. We are saying, oh, we expect the incoming JSON to be text, and then it's hopefully either regular or workshop, and in this case, we will produce the correct Haskell constructor, and otherwise we'll fail. But if you look at this, it's really more or less twice the same code. I mean, this looks more complicated than that, but what we're actually saying is there is a one-to-one correspondence between the Haskell constructor regular and the string regular, right? And we are writing that correspondence down twice in slightly different ways. That's not so great. And then it goes on. If we want to do the same thing for talk, we can perform a TookJSON instance where you say, okay, we match on the make talk constructor, which is the only thing, and then we have a number, an author, a title, and a category, and then we produce this JSON representation as an object, which has these different things. But we can also go the other way around and parse and say we expect the incoming JSON to be an object, and then we are producing a make talk thing by looking up in the incoming JSON dictionary these four fields which hopefully exist, and then combining them all together. And again, if you compare this and this, it really says, well, there is a correspondence between our Haskell data type and a JSON object which has these four different labels. Okay? And we are writing down twice more or less the same thing. And there's more. I mean, it's not just that we have to write this code, but there is a desired property, like a law we would like to hold, which basically says that if we go from a Haskell value and convert it to JSON and have a JSON string representation, and then we parse it back, we would like to have the same original ASCII value. So it's not just that we have to write this code that more or less expresses the same thing, but we also should hopefully write it in such a way that the property holds. And there is a potential for mistake. Okay? So in this particular case, it holds. So this doesn't apply just to JSON. If you look around in the Haskell library role, you will find lots of instances of this pattern. So there's binary serialization, for example, which has an interface like this. So you have a class for everything that you can serialize into some binary representation, and it has a put and a get method. They both produce some abstract types, but nevertheless, if you have one thing for one direction and one thing for the other direction. And if you look at the instances you would write, I won't go into the detail here because I don't spend too much time on binary serialization later. But again, you can see you're doing more or less the same thing. You're establishing that there is a relation. Hopefully, it's all compatible with each other. And in the same way for the talk instance, where either you put the four fields or you get the four fields, but again, you're essentially, you're writing the same thing. And there's more examples. Again, you have a round trip property here. There's more examples like SQL databases. So you have various Haskell libraries, like actually for communicating with databases, but many of them have classes like to row and from row. What's the goal here is if you have a value of a Haskell data type, then how do you convert that into a single row of a database table? And again, you have these two directions there, and again, you have to write two instances, and again, they are related in some way. Or even just normal textual representation, like a show and the read class in Haskell, where you are aiming at just producing a Haskell code-like textual representation. You have these two directions again, you have two different classes, and again, there is some kind of wrong property that you hold. And that's only part of the story. Like I've ignored this thing in the beginning with the encoding. So ASIN, for example, now has this not just the two JSON function, but also the two encoding function. So you actually have to write three times the same code if you want to benefit from the increased efficiency. And there is a sort of generic default for the two encode function that falls back on the two JSON representation, but if you're using the default implementation, you are not gaining anything about the efficiency, which is the main reason why this function was in. So the common theme here is we, in all these situations, we write two or even more programs, and the programs contain roughly the same or very similar information. And there are desired properties that we would wish to hold, but that are easily violated if we just write our code naively. So there is, fortunately, there is a standard solution to this in Haskell, which most people are using one way or the other, which is data type generic programming, or in some cases, people are using template Haskell. But I'll subsume that under this headline. So essentially, you're using a mechanism in the language that generates all these instances. And that's very attractive, because how does that work in our example? You're first deriving an instance of a magic class that's called generic for the two data types that you're interested in. And then you're writing empty instance declarations for all the other classes. And everything just works. So you get a two JSON instance for these two types, a from JSON instance, and a binary instance for these two types. And the round-trip properties hold, and everything is great. Talk at the end here. But let's have a look. So first of all, it looks like the talk should have been called write node program get many, because that's what we've just done. So first of all, I would argue that even there we have actually written a program, because data type generic programming is all about deriving programs from the data type and just writing down the data type in a way is a program that we've already written. So and that doubles as the program that determines all the other pieces of code here. But that's part of the problem. Because of this, the programs follow the structure of the data types that we've given precisely. And that's sometimes good, but it's not always good, right? I mean, if we are in control of the JSON representations of our Haskell files, then it might not matter. But there might be situations where we have to be compatible with JSON representations or JSON formats that have been specified by others. And they might not be aware that there is a particular generic program in the Haskell world that produces the JSON representations of the data type in a very particular way. They might have determined that the field label should look differently or that some types should be encoded differently. So this is not always good. And in general, I would say the disadvantages of using generic programming are that the external representations of your data are implicit, and they are under the control usually not of yourself, but of third-party library authors. So if you're using the generic programs that you write the from JSON and to JSON instances for you, you're trusting the author of the ASOMP library in this case to not just change the algorithm from one release to the next, which would completely break everything, right? And that's not, and that may even happen accidentally, right? And so that's in addition to the limited flexibility where you really want to follow a particular externally specified format. So I would argue that it's nicer to be explicit than implicit if you're building a long-term robust application and you want to specify your external format. So there seems to be a binary choice between two options that are both suboptimal. So either we can use the derived instances and be very happy that we don't have to write any boilerplate code, but we might have to live with fragile, changing, suboptimal external or internal representations. You actually see both, right? I mean, you see that people are accepting that the external format doesn't look as good as it could, but you also see that people are writing sort of bad or unidiomatic Haskell data types just so that the generic algorithm will produce the right thing, right? And the other choice seemed to be to write all the instances yourself and to stay in control, but then, as I've shown, you have to write lots of code by hand and it's very error-prone, and there are actually these subtle proof obligations for the wrong properties that even if you don't actually do the proofs, they still linger in your head and make you feel uncomfortable. So is there another option? So let's look at the concrete example, which is just a minor modification where we say, rather than having this representation here, which we used before, where we say the JSON representation of this talk would look like this, we want to use one which is slightly different. The first three fields are actually exactly the same, but rather than saying we have a category field which is either regular or workshop, we have an is workshop field, which is either true or false. So normally, if you wanted to do that now, you'd either have to change your Haskell data type so that the generic programming algorithm does the right thing, or you'd have to go back to the write both versions completely by hand scenario. So the actual solution is to use a single description that gives you both desired functions, or even all of them. This particular library here that I'm using is called JSON Grammar, and that predates the two encoding function in the ASON library, so at the moment with this version of the library you can only derive the normal to JSON and the parse JSON one. But you could imagine that with the same, exactly the same technique, you can derive all three. So so without going too much into detail at this point, what you see is that you have a program here that more or less describes what the structure of each of these data types is. So a talk is an object, is a JSON object with four properties that are named like this. And the order here actually matters. So so it says that these will be the four arguments that are ultimately applied or coming from the talk constructor. And the track has this association between the string regular and the string workshop and the constructor workshop and the constructor regular. So these things have underscores now. I've not yet explained that, but they correspond to the constructors. Right? So so roughly the colon is some form of the dot is some form of composition or sequencing, and this diamond operator is some form of choice. Okay, but it's nicer because if this is really enough, we can give this one instance declaration rather than two different ones, and we can derive from it both or even all three of the functions that we wanted before, and we are more or less guaranteed that they will fulfill the desired properties, then it's nice because it's explicit, so it can be different from the Haskell data type, right? We can make changes there. It's still strongly typed, it's easy to adapt, and it avoids the unnecessary repetition. So here is an example of how we can now switch the representation to the one that I wanted to use instead. So here we have four properties, number, name, title, and category. And I'm now going to change the fourth one to use a slightly different combinator, which rather than crop is calling property, it's workshop, and property, unlike crop, gives me the option of specifying a non-standard definition of how to parse or serialize the contents of this field, and there I define a bool track is either the JSON value false, which corresponds to regular, or the JSON value. Okay, so it's easy to adapt. And I can even go further now and do things like say, okay, actually on the JSON world, the is workshop field should be optional, and if it's not there, I would want to interpret that as being regular. So I can make further adaptations. Okay. So, let's take a slightly closer look at how this works. So, so we have these things that are called prisms that occur here. There's from prism. So, what are prisms? Prisms come from the area of lenses. So if you've heard of lenses, then prisms are for the similar things. And, if anyone is using Edward Pett's lens library, it also has a module for prisms. So a prism is essentially a generalization of a Haskell constructor, and you can think of it as combining the function that actually takes the argument values and constructs the compound value out of it, together with a compatible matching function that takes the compound value, checks whether it belongs to the right constructor, and either fails if it doesn't, or takes it apart and gives you back all the components. So in this particular case, you can think of stack prism as an abstract type, which essentially just pairs a function from A to B, where A you can think of as all the arguments of the constructors, of the constructor, and B being the final to be constructed value. So that's the constructor function. And B to maybe A being the matcher, which takes a compound value of type B, and checks whether it belongs to the right constructor, and if it does, it will give me all the arguments back. And then forward and backward are simply selecting either the first or the second component out of this pair. Right, forward is allowing you to forward apply the actual construction function, and backward is allowing you to extract the matcher. And then you have laws attached to these prisms. And interestingly, they are very compatible with our goals. So they are very similar to the router properties that we are after. So if we are constructing a compound value from our arguments according to some prism, and if we are then applying the same prism to match again, then that should always succeed. So if we apply a constructor and then match against that constructor, that should always succeed. So that should always give us just, and it should give us exactly the original arguments back. And in the other direction, if matching against the prism succeeds and gives us something back, then reconstructing the value using the prism should give us the original thing back as well. So how can we apply that to our concrete example? So for a talk, we have one constructor, which is called makeTalk, which takes four arguments. So in Haskell notation, the type of the makeTalk constructor would be int to text to text to track to talk, curried style. But that doesn't really match the A to B. We want something like A to B, where A is something and B is talk. Right, so the obvious thing that we can do, which doesn't really change anything, is rather than using the curried style, we can use the uncurried style and take a tuple of all the arguments. But that's not so nice to work with in practice, because Haskell, the tuple types are all different for every arity. And then we have lots of large tuples with unknown arity to deal with all the time and to take apart. So what can we do instead? We could use nested pairs. Then we only have to deal with pairs and the units tied in the end to mark the end. And that's actually essentially what we're going to do, or what this library that I'm talking about is doing. So this step is sort of broken, but so there is one step from here to here where we can observe that if we, rather than ending with an empty tuple, we could also end with anything if we also return that again. So going from here to here is just a generalization. And then there is a nicer syntax that is being used. These are called like type level stacks, which are essentially just nested pairs still, but rather than writing them with the standard Haskell notation, we're writing a nested pair now with an infix operator. And so it's even stacked on top of text, stacked on top of text, stacked on top of trunk. And then there is the rest of the stack, which is unspecified. And now in this form, we can easily see that we can make it fit the prism type, where we can say that in the case of talk, the B is talk cons S, and the A is int cons text, cons track, cons X. So the underscore talk that we've seen before is of type stack prism, which relates the arguments of the make talk constructor. Actually, it should be better called make talk, not underscore talk. Underscore make talk. The arguments of the make talk constructor and the final. That should also be. So here you have a lot of mistakes on one So make talk, colon, colon, and then the final thing which should be talk. Truck. Let me see if I have more mistakes on this slide. So here are a couple of stacks how they would look like for other well-known data types. So for Booleans, you would have false and true as constructors. They both don't take any arguments. So you go from any stack without anything on it with a single Boolean. And go cases for nothing and just. Nothing is again a constructor without any argument. So it relates the stack S with the stack which has maybe A on top. And just takes a single A to maybe A or back. And then for lists and pairs, we can define prisms like this as well. Okay? So that's actually the most important ingredient in enabling this kind of bidirectionality that I'm after. And obtaining these stack prisms in the first place, that's something that we can really do again via generic programming or template testing. And these are always the same, so that works nicely. So if we have a generic program, in this case it's called make prism list, that we can call in order to extract all the stack prisms for a particular data file, then we can use them later. Okay. So let's take another look at these descriptions now. As you can see here in the beginning, we have from prism applied to underscore talk, which again should be actually be called make talk, but it's just a suboptimal name. So that either constructs a talk out of four components, which we are building up here, 1, 2, 3, 4 properties, right? Or it destroys the talk into four components, which are then going to be consumed by these four things. But it's important to realize this is all still typed, and the type checker will make sure that we're not forgetting something here, or that we're not flipping type, like the properties of different types here, because otherwise the code wouldn't type check. Right. So this is now the actual description is of type grammar, and grammars are also specified, parameterized by stacks. So we're dealing with things of type grammar N, A, B, where N is the syntactic category, because JSON is actually slightly complicated in the sense that like there are things that can occur inside of objects but not outside of objects. For example, properties don't make sense on the top level, they only make sense they appear within an object, and that is handled by this extra type argument N here. And then there is the source stack of the targets. And I can look at a couple of examples to hopefully illustrate that. So if we ask in GHCI, what is the type of from prism regular, we see that that turns a stack prism into a grammar. And since regular is a nullary constructor that produces a track, it is a grammar that relates something of stack A with something of stack track from Z. Now if we look at what is the type of lowercase false, well, that is just a grammar representing the JSON Boolean false, and that is just a grammar that only works in what's called the value syntactic context of a JSON description, and it takes a single value and relates it with nothing. So that's because we are only parsing or accepting a single value, basically, and we're not yet saying what kind of Haskell representation we want for it. So now we can compose from prism regular with false. And this composition operator here works on grammars much like it works for functions, in that it composes the stacks. So here, false is something that expects a stack with a value on it and drops the value. From prism regular is something that expects any stack and pushes a track on it. So the composition of the two takes a stack that needs to have a value on it and ends up with a stack that has a track on it. And this is how you can combine later larger things by using some generalized form of function composition. And then you can use a generic grammar-based decoding and encoding functions that take a particular grammar as a description to derive both directions. So we can use gdecode with this grammar and pass the path of the string false, and we get just regular back. But we can also take gencode with the same grammar and pass it the Haskell value regular and get the string false back. Right, so we have both directions encoded in this description. And that's the key point. So the composition operator is looking just like a function composition, only specialized to the grammar. So it takes a grammar from B to C, and a grammar from A to B, and a grammar from A to C, where A, B, and C are stacks of types. And there is this choice operator, which combines two grammars. And what does it mean? A choice for a parser means that try to parse it as the first thing, or try to parse it as the second thing. And a choice for a printer means that, yeah, look, if this is belonging to the right constructor so that you can render it as the first thing, or otherwise try to render it as the second thing. But both things have to be a compatible point. So, how does this all come together? So in this particular example, we'll have one class there, which is called JSON, rather than from JSON to JSON, and it just has a grammar, rather than a separate parser and a separate printer. So there is just this one thing. And on the top level, all Haskell data types correspond to JSON values, we'll always have a grammar in the val category, which relates a single JSON universally typed value with something of a concrete Haskell type A. Okay, and then we have grammar-based encoding and decoding functions, as I've shown before, that now can take a grammar description and either give us the direction where we go from the Haskell type to the string, or give us the direction where we go from the string back to the Haskell type. And ideally, we have rounder properties. So the expectation here is that this thing holds, that if we can take a Haskell value and encode that using a particular grammar and that succeeds, that we can decode the resulting string using the same grammar and get the original Haskell value. Now, do we actually prove this? So actually proving this is hard still, because, well, this ultimately still relies on the ASON library. And for starters, we would have to know that the ASON library fulfills the rounder properties that we look for it to fulfill. ASON is a big library and it's changing. And so, but it's reasonable, I would say. I haven't done it, but it's reasonable to imagine that you can at least prove that your code, or this particular bidirectional code that you've written, doesn't make things worse. Because you have a number of grammar building combinators, and you can, under the assumption that the underlying ASON library fulfills the desired rounder property, just basically do an induction over each construct in your combinator language, which says that if each construct preserves the rounder property, if you assume that it holds all the underlying components, that you then have a good guarantee that any grammar-based description that you can go also fulfills the right properties. Okay? So, yeah, let's actually step back a bit and look at what have we achieved. So there is a better representation. So this is actually the main point. Rather than writing two or even three, if you give an encoder separately, programs that are all related in some way and that have an implicit attached proof obligation, we have now written a single program that is at a higher level and that contains exactly the right information to derive uniquely all these two or three different programs in such a way that the property more or less is guaranteed to hold. Right? It doesn't even need to stop there. So for example, as I said, the JSON grammar library that I'm using as an example here is slightly is predating the latest version of the ASAP library, but so it doesn't actually derive the two encoding, but it could. But it does give you an extra feature where you can derive some sort of interface description of your JSON as well. And you could imagine that, for example, you could, with a little bit of extra annotation, you could make the grammar description explicit enough so that you could automatically derive a JSON schema from the same description as well. So you don't necessarily have to stop at two different things. You can think of what interrelated things do I have in my program that I need for a particular data type. Is there a single description that I can give from which I can derive them all? So that is an interesting question. So I should talk a little bit about the solutions that are out there. So as I've said several times now, this is the code that I've shown is all based on this JSON grammar library, which is by Mertheimer staying there. But that's not the only solution like this. So the same idea that you use stack prisms, composition, ultimately form a DSL of descriptions that can then be interpreted in multiple different ways, that applies in the same way to the other scenarios that I've shown or talked about at the beginning. So you can apply the same trick so that you can avoid doing a separate put and get function for binary serialization. You can apply the same trick so that you can avoid having to write a separate from row and to row instance. All at the same time as still being able to give an explicit description of what your external format should look like and not relying just blindly on the generic algorithm. And the same also applies to just arbitrary human-readable textual representations. So that actually, there are two classic Haskell libraries that are dealing with the general problem of invertible syntax description. So there is this invertible syntax library by Tilman Wendel, which was a Haskell Symposium 2010 paper, but there is also Roundtrip, which is by Stefan Beer and David Leuschner. So people are organizing this conference. Roundtrip has itself a number plugins where you can use the underlying core for doing different things. So there's Roundtrip String for just read and show, essentially. There's also Roundtrip XML, which is yet another scenario, which gives you invertible XML serialization. And there's also a Roundtrip ASON library, which is another approach which does a relatively similar thing to JSON grammar. And Roundtrip works slightly differently, not using the stacks in exactly the same way, but actually using something like nested tuples. But it is still the same. And then there are other applications in more specialized areas as well. So there is a Boomerang and WebRoots Boomerang library, which is specific to the scenario of parsing and rendering URLs, which is a very small thing. But still, if you say, a particular endpoint of a web application is composed of this string followed by that string followed by this capture followed by that, you again have a description which essentially can be interpreted in two directions. And WebRoot Boomerang is in turn again based on a library called Svalu, which again kind of goes back to the more time on screen there. So the same, well, partially the same people who have for just. So this is a technique that you can apply widely. And in a way, Servant is similar. So Servant is a type level web description language, and it moves more stuff to the type level, but it's a similar idea. So by essentially saying there is an API component of the web application that is isolated as a separate description, then we have a concise description from which we can derive things like a client, app, a server, and documentation, rather than doing this all over and over again without having any relation between them. So the more general message here is to choose suitable representations for your program. Really, if you feel like you're writing several programs over and over again that are interrelated in complicated ways, then you're probably doing it wrong. Then you should think about, like, is there something that I can expose, some other abstract description, so that I can derive both? And I would also say, to be completely fair, a lot of these libraries that I've mentioned before, they have certain problems. Or let's say they are perhaps not as widely applicable as one would like to be. And I have actually rarely ended up using any of these, but I'm using the technique all the time. And one good point to realize is that when you're working in a particular application, you often have extra knowledge that doesn't necessarily apply to the general scenario, but it applies to your application. You always have a JSON representation and, let's say, an XML representation, and they are related in a particular way. And that may not hold for any other scenario, but in your particular application, you know it always holds. And then you can go even further and say you restrict yourself to the subset of data types that you're actually going to use, which always are of a particular form, and you define a specific representation for these so that you can derive all the code that you need from this particular thing. And so often you can actually, in an easier way, because you are not having to deal with all the special cases and the whole big world, write code like this in your own applications. Okay, that is what I wanted to say. Thank you. Do you have a question? So the prism for talk here in this particular case, that gives you the four elements of the talk constructor or the make talk constructor in their standard order. But you could plug in something now that, like, takes the stack and reorders it in a way that is usually inverse. Basically just flips two elements or flips them the other way around. And there's no reason why you cannot do that. So you're not. It's sort of most convenient if the order matches the one that you're using in your Haskell data types, but it's not a necessity.
I was wondering why G encoded terms in A to A is A.
Yeah, so that's a very good question. That's a slightly annoying thing, because the actual JSON encode, where do I have G encode? The actual JSON encode doesn't ever fail, right? But in our scenario now, both the encoding and the decoding have a potential for failure. This is because the individual building blocks, like if you look at something like this, from prism, regular, compose, with false, this can fail both in the rendering and in the parsing direction. So it only accepts the string false in order to give you regular, and on any other input it will fail. But it also only accepts something of constructor regular in the rendering direction. And if the incoming value is of any other Haskell constructor, it will fail in that branch, hoping that there is a choice of alternatives where another branch matches. But since we start from these possibly failing renderers, it is unsafe to assume that your grammar description is actually exhaustive. So that is, that's not so great. I mean, it's possible to think about a way where you could basically give yourself a specialized choice combinator that forces you to deal with all the cases exhaustively, and then you can get rid of them maybe again. Or you can just believe it in sort of from just it's a good observation. So that's
is it possible,
or
is it very
that's again a weakness. I mean, actually, in preparing this talk, I started writing my own re-implementation of JSON grammar, because I had already a partial re-implementation for another purpose lying around, and this, that's another thing that is that's an artifact of this particular library that you're returning maybe always, but actually itself has become, like, it's still not optimal, but it has become significantly better in terms of error messages and recent versions, and it's entirely possible to propagate that tool so that you get the better error messages out. So there's no theoretical problem